everyone. It's a huge honor to be here. Starting off, firstly, I must say the two things that I try to do at Gensler today, I actually didn't study either of them. So the first one is actually around behavior change. Behavior and behavior change in particular. I'm not a psychologist by training. And the other is actually space design and experience design. So where it really started was, I don't know how many of you have watched TED Talks in particular. There's a very famous TED Talker by the name of Rory Sutherland. He's an ad man, actually. And so he has this brilliant talk called Sweat the Small Stuff, where he asks this particular question. He says, look, if we kind of broadly categorize things, they can be one of two things. You know, they can fall on a scale of stuff that either costs very little to costs a lot, or it can be stuff that has very little impact or has a lot of impact. And so he says, if we give examples of what fall into these four categories, the first one is really strategy, right? So strategy has a big impact and actually costs a lot of money as well. The second one, stuff that costs a lot of money and has very little impact, said an example is consulting, right? So there's a lot of advice, but very little outcome as a result of it. I'm a consultant myself, ma'am, so I can absolutely understand. The third thing he says that costs very little money and has very little impact is trivia, general knowledge, stuff that we know about. But then the question that was asked was, what about this fourth quadrant? You know, what happens when with stuff that actually costs very little money but has a big impact? This question was very interesting to me, and actually, you know, there was a lot of stuff I was reading at that time about, you know, the ideas of nudge, the ideas of behavior change, all of that, and it kind of started to tie in together. So, always willing to experiment, we started off really small, trying to answer, you know, what would this look like as far as space and design is considered. You see these applications in government policy nowadays of this fourth quadrant. For example, in Britain, all they had to do to increase taxes was right at the end of the tax form, you actually ask people to sign on the fact that everything that they've declared so far is true. Instead of putting it at the end of the form, they put it at the beginning of the form. And suddenly, when people said that, yes, we are actually truthfully telling everything that we will spell out in the form, there was a huge impact in how truthfully they reported their earnings. So it was small things like this that are starting to show their impact in marketing, in government policy, but what about space and space design? So we decided that we'd start small, and this is where we started. So this is a picture of a very crude picture. I'm sorry, I took it off my cell phone of our pantry, and you can see clean fascias, all white, designers have been at work, right? So essentially, the problem that was being faced was, in order to keep these clean fascias, the way that the doors would latch on is this magnetic catch right at the back at the bottom corner of these two drawers. And this was the same fixture that was used on the overall pantry, even for the drawers and all that. Now, the thing was, people would have a lot of unsuccessful attempts in just trying to close these damn things. It's a really small problem. But when we noticed, people would be bang, 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 latch. And as a result of that, it was an experience sore point. Let's just put it that way, right? So what we thought was, well, now in the traditional method, what you'd ideally do was you'd say, okay, let's try to change around all the fixtures, or you'd say, let's try to put up a poster that explains to you that actually if you press right in front of where that fixture is, it'll actually close. We said, well, you know, instructing people, telling people what to do is treating them like they're dumb, right? People are not dumb. People are smart. So what's missing here? So what we decided to do was, we had an idea. We didn't know whether it would work, but we decided to try it out anyway. So on day one, we went, sat down in this pantry space and noted four things. Number of people who came in, number of times they actually tried to close these things, number of total attempts and number of unsuccessful attempts, right? So we noted these four things down. And then that evening, once everyone had left, quietly without telling everyone, this is what we did. We just added stickers at the point where they were supposed to press. That's all we did. We didn't tell anyone what they were for. We didn't tell anyone what we were doing, why we did it. We just added the stickers. Next day, again, one of us went into the pantry, sat down and quietly noted. What happened was the number of unsuccessful attempts in closing this damn thing went down by 2/3. That means there was a reduction of 67% in one day in the number of unsuccessful attempts that this had. Now, we were very excited. Okay, we're on to something here. It's a really small example, but at least it shows its work. So then we thought, okay, let's get bigger. How do we start doing this? One of the things that the firm does, and something that I do a lot with my team, is something called change management, where, you know, we've had this idea that we've been talking about of changing workplaces. Employees go to these changed workplaces. How can they be productive from day one is something that we try to help organizations figure out. So this is an example of a bank. These were the new workspaces that they were getting. As you can see, lovely renders. We didn't design it. But then, and as we presented this new workspace to all the employees in the bank, they were very excited. They were like, oh, great, we're getting this really cool new workplace. Shifted in, and immediately what happened was none of these spaces were really being used. So then they thought, well, you know, management was really perplexed. I thought everyone loved the idea. But when we actually started to analyze the problem, we went and actually asked a few people, you know, why do you know that there are these collaborative and focused spaces within your workplace? Yes, they knew. Why aren't you using them? Not quite sure. Instinctively, they picked up something that they couldn't quite articulate. And as we looked at, you know, the images, the way that the workplace came out was very close to these images, we started to realize something. And I'll actually pose you this challenge. Can you tell me which of these workplaces is, or which of these areas is collaborative space and which is quiet space? There are two quiet spaces in here, there are two collab spaces in here. They look the same, don't they? Actually, this is what it is. Now, if you start to notice the collab spaces, now there's basic psychology that goes in when you try to design spaces, right? You want convergent spaces in collab areas. You want divergent spaces when you don't want people to face each other. You want co-locational spaces. Examples like libraries are great examples of that, where you don't want to acknowledge the presence of the other person. It's all over the place. There are collaborative settings in the quiet space because they're convergent by nature. The collab space actually has reception-like settings, all because A, it looks great, and B, we have this idea of how people collaborate that doesn't really translate with, you know, how actually people behave. So what we decided to do was one weekend, all we said was, okay, again, by stealth, traditional method would have been we go, you know, talk to all the employees, we hold workshops, and we actually try to tell them that there's this great collab space here. We put up posters everywhere that please go and collaborate in these collab spaces. People don't quite behave that way. So all we did was we told the client one weekend, one space, give us a couple of guys, and we're going to shift furniture around. This was all loose furniture, right? So what we did was we completely screwed up their design, picked up furniture design settings that we thought would actually work for a collab setting, and played around with it in a way that we thought settings would actually be used. So one floor, one collab area, we redid that. And Monday morning, again, no one said anything. All the employees showed up, and we quietly just started noting utilization data. Now, prior to this, there had been very little utilization of that space. Over the next 3 days, the average utilization of that space went up to 40-45%, and the peak utilization was actually at 70%. We didn't have to tell people a thing. People instinctively pick these things up, you know. If something is intuitive by use, people will go and use it. And so that aspect of things was, the client firstly was very skeptical because they were like, well, you're not really doing anything. But then once they saw the result, they were completely transformed. So what they actually decided to then do was, going forth with all their projects, they said, you guys need to have a design review role. So we actually sit down with the designer, review the way that they've actually organized their spaces, and talk and try to think about it from a standpoint of how would people actually use this space. Now you'd think that, you know, something like this costs very little money, is of great use to a client, would be an easy sell, right? You'd actually, I mean, clients would be eating out of our hands saying, we need more of this stuff. This is exactly how you're going to help us unlock all these investments we've made to make it more effective. The issue is kind of this. the way we've been all programmed is to think that big problems can only come from with big solutions, can only be solved with big solutions. There's a linearity mechanical model of the world we have where, you know, if the problem's big, we need to solve it big. It's very rare that we think that small, stupid things that we do can have big impact. And the second thing is, especially as far as, you know, trying to converse with organizations is concerned, is that there is this thing called the Excel sheet. And the Excel sheet is the big, you know, you can't demonstrate the stuff that I just showed you on an Excel sheet. And if I can't portray this on an Excel sheet, the guy who needs to take a decision is not going to take a decision. Simply because, and again, psychology is at play here, people take decisions not to maximize, but they take a decision that will not get them fired. Right? This is a ploy that's risky. If people take this decision and it backfires, they could get fired. I asked you to do something, you didn't actually do it, you went this whole other way, and now it's blown up in your face. So, you'd be surprised at how difficult it becomes to sell something that is of benefit to people when they actually have to put in an effort. I mean, I'm guilty of it myself. I have a gym membership. It's paid for. And I don't use it because it requires effort on my part to actually go to the gym, right? So we're all kind of guilty of this. And what we're hoping is, as we kind of go forward, we build more and more examples of this. We're hoping that we slowly build a database of things like this enough that it becomes undeniable. And we can start then actively designing for behavior change rather than figuring out just letting behavior happen. Thank you.